In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, what are the prescribed zones in walls for installing cables to accessories? This question relates to the video that Gary and I made on the subject of the Evolve range of sockets from BG. They're great looking and the fronts are really simple to change, so please go and check that video out after watching this one, of course. So let's talk about the subject for this video. There are two reasons we want to be concerned about installing cables in prescribed zones. One is to protect the cable from damage, like having screws or nails belted through them, and the other is to protect the person doing the belting of said screws or nails. Once a cable is buried in a wall behind plasterboard and surface finishes, there may not be any signs of it to the layperson or even the professional. So BS 7671 outlines two options. We find the first in regulation 522.6.202, where we read, a cable installed in a wall or partition at a depth of less than 50mm from a surface of the wall or partition shall... Now we're going to stop right there because that actually is our first option. We can bury the cable more than 50mm deep in the wall and that's it. No other protection is required at all. However, you may need to install RCD protection for other reasons. For example, if it's a circuit feeding domestic lighting circuits. It's likely that at this depth, even the most gung-ho of DIYers won't be volleying in 2-inch screws or nails. Of course, getting your cable buried to that depth may be a challenge, and not just for your poor apprentice's tired arms as they volley it in with a hammer and bolster, but also because it can start to affect the structural integrity of the building. For more information on that, please check out the free accredited training package that we've made on this subject on the know-how page at eFIXX.co.uk. However, let's say we're installing the cable in the real world at a normal depth, it's very likely that we'll be installing at a much shallower depth than 50mm, and so one of the options in this regulation will be required. So what's the first option? The regulation continues. 1. Be installed in a zone within 150mm from the top of the wall or partition, or within 150mm of an angle formed by two adjoining walls or partitions. Where the cable is connected to a point, accessory or switchgear on any surface of the wall or partition, the cable may be installed in a zone either horizontally or vertically to the point, accessory or switchgear. Where the location of the accessory point or switchgear can be determined from the reverse side, a zone formed on one side of a wall of 100mm thickness or less, or partition of 100mm thickness or less, extends to the reverse side. Or, we'll look at the or option in a moment, but let's unravel that paragraph first. We can install cables buried less than 50mm deep in a zone around the top of a room or vertically in a corner that is 150mm wide. Going off that definition, I would say where we've got coving installed, that the 150mm starts from where the wall and ceiling meet behind the coving, not 150mm down from the coving. So that's pretty simple and can be super helpful where your options are limited. For instance, I once had to rewire a ground floor flat with concrete ceilings, so all the cables were run around the tops of the wall in this prescribed zone. Then there's the issue of getting cables down the walls to sockets and switches. The regulation allows you to run vertically or horizontally to accessories, which again makes sense from an end user point of view, as hopefully they'll look at the accessory and think that the cable will go straight out, either up, down, left or right. So can you run a cable diagonally to an accessory? Well, much as it makes me want to be a little bit sick in my mouth, yes you can, if it's buried more than 50mm deep in the wall, or complies with the second option in this reg. As an electrician of nearly 25 years, I would not be availing myself of that option. It's just ingrained in me not to do it. But another question gets raised here, and it's one that's been debated back and forth a fair bit on social media. In this situation, let's say I've got a cooker switch and the cooker outlet plate is below and to the left of the switch. Could I bury the outgoing cable in the wall and have it change direction so it enters the outlet plate here? Now, I really want to emphasize at this point, this isn't to be critical of anyone else's opinion, and I must admit I've been backwards and forwards over it a bit in my head, but having sought advice from the ECA and a member of JPL64, the answer is yes, you can. If you think about it, if these were two completely separate accessories, then it wouldn't be an issue to run a horizontal cable from here and a vertical one from here. So it's not a problem for the cable to change direction at this point, as long as it stays in the prescribed zone, especially in this situation where the cable is connecting the two accessories together. Obviously, if you want to go beyond this and not change the direction of the cable in the prescribed zone, then that's also fine, but to install the cable, as shown here, is compliant with the regs. It's also worth noting that last part, where the wall is 100mm thick or less, the zone formed on one side extends to the other face. Interesting that the wording there is the zone formed, indicating that the accessory defines the horizontal and vertical areas where it's acceptable to install the cable. Now, if you're watching this, it's likely you're an electrician and are already aware of these prescribed zones. But as a chippy said to me once on site after nailing through a cable in just such a zone, where's our information on these zones? It's a good point. Is the wider world aware of these zones? You'd hope a little common sense would prevail, but it doesn't always. Maybe that's why these zones are usually referred to as prescribed zones rather than safe zones these days, because they're not actually intrinsically safe. They don't offer protection to the cables from incompetent people or even to the people themselves. That's why there's another layer of protection required at the bottom of 522.6.202. Where indent 1, but not indent 2 applies, the cable shall be provided with additional protection by means of an RCD having the characteristics specified in regulation 415.1.1, which basically means a 30 milliamp device. So if you're installing twin and CPC into an installation less than 50 mil deep and it's in the safe zones, you have to use RCD protection for that. This is in place because in reality, even getting cables into the prescribed zones doesn't mean no one will ever drill or nail through a cable, and the RCD protection ensures that if anyone does hit a cable and either create an earth fault or get a shock to earth themselves, then the RCD will disconnect and keep them safe. Again, it's really important to note that prescribed zones and RCD protection must be used together to comply with the indent that we've just discussed. You can't miss out RCD protection because the cables are in the zones, and you can't install cables buried just anywhere and rely on RCD protection to comply. Both must be used in conjunction with each other to comply. If you choose not to use the prescribed zones or deeper than 50mm method, then there is another way. We can comply with indent 2 of 522.6.202, which directs us that we should, 2, comply with regulation 522.6.204. This regulation outlines a number of options. Indents 1 to 3 gives us the option to use cable or cable management with earth metallic protection enclosing the conductors, namely SWA, steel conduit and steel trunking. Indent 4 outlines a vague option for mechanical protection to prevent the penetration of nails and screws, and indent 5 shows us that PELV and SELV systems don't require any extra protection as they would struggle to present a dangerous voltage to individuals coming into contact with them. So in reality, for a domestic setting, because most of the circuits, lighting, sockets, showers, ovens with a socket on the cooker control unit, etc., will require additional protection in the form of an RCD anyway, it makes sense to keep cables in prescribed zones and protect them with an RCD rather than going to all the trouble of using SWA, steel conduit or steel trunking. So that's our take on prescribed zones as outlined in BS 7671. If you found this helpful, then check out our videos here. Thank you very much for watching.